inequality and housing the poor, it becomes quite easy for me to introduce the next speaker, which is Sennett, because I think if there is someone who for the last 30, 40 years, certainly in the English language to start off with, because that's the language in which he writes, has been a keen observer of the issues of social integration and the relationship between physical form and social integration, and therefore equally attentive to the issues of the creation of social exclusion by the structuring of urban form. Richard has and is a professor at the London School of Economics, but also teaches at New York University, where he's a professor of sociology. He's the chairman of the Cities Program, which is one of the elements, obviously, which organizes this event together with the Herrhausen Society, and is also teaching at the MIT. So it's my pleasure to ask him to reflect on the issues of urban inequality, which will then lead on to the next session on housing the poor. So would you welcome Richard Sennett.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to come to Mumbai, and turning out to be a very, very productive session for your visitors from abroad. And I hope both in the informal and informal sessions that we have over remaining to us in the next day and a half, we'll really be able to articulate a set of common interests and problems that we share. I come to you with one of those problems, which was one of the reasons for creating the Urban Age Project itself. And that was, that problem is, that urban design went into a kind of creative decline in the 20th century. The art of making cities became an art that became increasingly crude and unable to respond to the realities of social life in cities as they changed, particularly in the latter half of the 20th century. And part of the point of the urban age is for professionals themselves to recover some of the art of making cities, something that we have to do by a lot of thought often, whereas in earlier ages, this seemed like kind of almost instinctive practice about making environments. I want to speak to you today about one of the challenges to recovering the art of urban design. And it has to do with dealing with the problem of changes in global capitalism. What kind of visual forms are appropriate to this profound change in the political economy of today's modern world? And in particular, what kinds of visual or physical forms are appropriate to dealing with one, probably the gravest of the deficits of this global system, which is the increase in inequality that it generates. Excuse me, I misspoke, the reformulation of inequality that it's generated in the last two generations. How can a designer go about addressing the phenomenon of inequality? And I just want to share with you in the next 20 minutes some thoughts about this. This is a huge problem. And I've thought about it in a rather homely way. And it has to do, my thoughts on this recur to the Hippocratic Oath that all doctors take. And the Hippocratic Oath, as you know, actually not devised by Hippocrates, but no matter. The Hippocratic Oath is do no harm. And I think the issue for us has a parallel in the world of urban design. How can we do no harm in design? That is, in this context, how can we not make inequality worse by the things that we design? The Hippocratic Oath is not a negative formulation. Do no harm inspires the doctor to look closely at the conditions of well-being. What Hippocrates did say is that you're likely to treat a patient better if you investigate the fine grain of his condition rather than generalize about his illness. And that, it seems to me, is a wonderful guide for us today in thinking about how we too can take the Hippocratic Oath in cities to do no harm, and so to make our cities at least more resistant to the pressures of inequality. Let me say, since I have very little time, just to name two features of the dynamism that has spread over the globe in the last 30 years, which bear on the problem of urban design. These are features of capitalism which have to do with its time frame as well as its spatiality. The first of them has to do with the phenomenon of what has been called impatient capital. That is investment in projects, principally in urban projects, in which the investors want a quick return to their investments, in which they did not intend to become long-term owners. And this behavior in the physical realm is based on the way in which impatient capital works as stock markets have become globalized. People who invest in stocks and even in bonds are no longer long-term owners, but who proceed to control companies, but rather are seeking for short-term gains in the prices of shares. I'll just give you one example of how this works. In the United States, pension funds, who should be the most conservative of all investors in stocks and bonds, 35 years ago, tended to hold stocks for an average of 46 months. As of last year, they tended to hold them for 4 months. So even the most conservative of investors have become sources of impatient capital. And that has had a profound effect on the way in which cities are financed. The second issue, a large change in this capitalism that bears on our particular problem, has to do with the phenomenon of chameleon institutions. That is to say, in reacting to these impatient capitalists, many managers and many institutions themselves re-engineer themselves over the short term, changing their business focuses, how they're organized, and where they're organized, in order to meet the demands of investors who want short-term returns on investing. That is, the chameleon turns out to be a rather more attractive investment proposition than change of any sort. Than firms that have a fixed purpose, long-term goals, and rather steady development. These are unsexy and tend to suffer in today's market. Now, both of these aspects, impatient capital and chameleon institutions, have had an effect on inequality in modern cities. For one thing, they both push towards increasing the scale of cities. That is because investors prefer much more to invest in very large cities than they do in medium-sized cities or small towns. The notion is that the federal character of very large cities is going to produce businesses which are likely to change, take on that chameleon quality, and so be investable in.